السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلله فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. الحج أشهر معلومات، فمن فرض فيهن الحج فلا رفث ولا فسوق ولا جدال في الحج، وما تفعلوا من خير يعلمه الله، وتزودوا فإن خير الزاد التقوى، واتقون يا أولي الألباب. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the Hajj, of course, is in the 9 months. So whoever is going to fulfill that obligation, then he should know that there is no rafath, there is no obscenities, there are no marital relations, wala fusuq, and there are no sins, wala jidala fil hajj, and there is no arguments during the Hajj. وَمَا تَفْعَلُوا مِنْ خَيْرٍ يَأْلَمْهُ اللَّهِ. And everything of good you do, Allah is aware of it. وَتَزَوَّدُوا. And take a provision, and the best provision to take is taqwa. وَاتَّقُونِ يَا أُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. And to have taqwa of me, O men of understanding. Allah clarifies for us, my dear brothers, in this particular verse in Surah Al-Baqarah, that the most important provision to take for those intending to perform the Hajj, and the days are only around the corner for us, Allah clarifies for us, whether we're performing the Hajj or not performing the Hajj, that the best provision that anyone could ever take is taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah draws our attention away from the external, where sometimes our minds are so keen to make sure we have all of the external elements for our journey, that we have enough of this and we have enough of that, and we have all the tangible things with us for our journey. But Allah says that the best provision you could take, the best thing you could take for your journey, is not the external things, but the best provision you can take is taqwa. Allah reminds us about the importance of the one that is internal, rather than the one that is external. About the internal provision, rather than the external provision. About the internal wealth, rather than the external wealth. Like Imam al-Shafi'i would say, rahmatullah alayhi wa ammal, as for the one who is ghani, فَلَيْسَ الْغَنِي بِمَالِهِ وَبِمُلْكِهِ. He's not wealthy on account of his money, or wealthy on account of his kingdoms and his people, but he's ghani, he is wealthy on account of his halihi, on account of his state, on account of his health, on account of his inner being and his inner disposition, his inner state. So Allah says that the best provision you can take for your journey for the Hajj is taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The same thing that Umar ibn Abdul Aziz reminded us about, rahmatullah alayhi, usikum bi taqwa Allah. I am instructing you about the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allati la yuqbalu ghayruha. The thing that Allah doesn't accept except this thing. Wala yuthib illa alayha. And does not reward except this thing called taqwa. فَإِنَّ الْوَاعِظِينَ بِهَا كَثِيرٌ وَالْعَامِلِينَ بِهَا قَلِيلٌ. Because those who are speaking about it are so many, but those who are acting by it are so few. It is that thing, my dear brothers, about which the poet said, مَنْ لَمْ يَلْبِسْ ثِيَابًا مِنَ التُّقَى تَتَقَلَّبَ عَرِيَانًا وَلَوْ كَانَ كَاسِيًا. As for the one who isn't wearing this garment, with this provision, that one is naked even though he thinks he's clothed. It goes like this, my dear brothers, as Ibn al-Qayyim says, اعلم أنه لا وصول إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى إلا بالتجرد والانفراد بخدمته. There is no arriving to Allah. There is no reaching, getting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, except by removing everything from yourself and entering into the state of submission to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala as a servant and a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the things that Ibn Qudama mentions as an advice for those performing the Hajj, and as an advice for all of us, because we too, by the mercy of Allah, may live during the days of Dhul-Hijjah. It's also a blessing for us, as it's a blessing for them. But it's about trying to understand what is the great importance of the Hajj for those performing the Hajj, and for us who are seeing those performing the Hajj, or we have relatives who are performing the Hajj, or friends or neighbors. He says, وَمِنْ ذَلِكَ أَنْ يَتَذَكَّرْ. amongst the lessons we should learn from the Hajj is for us to remember تحصيل الزاد زاد الآخرة من الأعمال ولا يحذر أن تكون أعماله فاسدة من الرياء. The first lesson perhaps we should learn from the Hajj is that the provision that people are taking from, remember the Hajj in history was a place of tijara, was a place of trade, was a time of trade. It was the month that the pre-Islamic Arabs used to take much delight in because they're making so much money, so much profit, because they're selling their gods and they're having all of this commerce, all of this trade. But when Allah sent our Prophet ﷺ with the noble message of Islam and granted him Nubuwwah, then it all changed. The most important trade you're making is that trade with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The most important provision you're taking is taking the provision that benefits you, not in this life, but in the next life. تحصيل الزاد زاد الآخرة من الأعمال with good deeds. In the hadith, من أتى هذا البيت فلم يرفث ولم يفسق رجع كما ولدته أمه. Whoever comes to this house, Baytullah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Bayt al-Haram, and does not indulge in obscenities or have relations with his wife during those days of Hajj and does not commit sin, he returns as if his mother gave birth to him. That is not an external state. He's still who he is, but that is an internal state. That is a state to do with his inner being, that Allah has cleansed him of all sins. In the hadith collected by Imam al-Tabarani, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَلْ يُبَايِبِ الْحُجَّجَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ, Allah boasts to the angels about who? About the Hujjaj. Allah boasts to them about those performing the pilgrimage. وَيَقُولَ, and Allah says, أُنظُرُوا إِلَىٰ عِبَادِي, look at my servants. Allah tells the angels, look at my servants. أَتُونِي شُؤَثًا غُبْرًا مِنْ كُلِّ فَجٍ عَمِيقٍ, they come to me dusty and disheveled from every distant and deep highways. أُشْهِدْكُمْ أَنِّي قَدْ غَفَرْتُ لَهُمْ, bear witness, I have forgiven those people. Bear witness, I have forgiven them. That is not an external state, that is an internal one. Allah has removed their sins from them. And so that's the first thing to remember. It's about ikhlas. وَلَا يَحْذَرْ أَن تَكُونَ أَعْمَالُهُ فَاسِدًا مِنَ الرِّيَاءِ. How many people try to do great things, perform the Hajj or read Quran or pray Salah, but the key ingredient, my dear brothers, are two things. Like Fudayl ibn Ayyad, like Ibn al-Mubarak, and so many of the ulama, they said, we must establish our actions upon the sunnah. Must establish our actions upon the sunnah. And number two, we must ensure that our actions are sincere. They have ikhlas. They have sincerity. And تكون حركته, to make your movement and your stillness in في سره, in your secrecy and in your open state in front of the people. لله تعالى وحده لا يمازجه شيئا لا نفس ولا هوى ولا دنيا. And that sincerity should not be fused, should not be mixed or clouded by things to do with your nafs, with your desires, or with the dunya. And لا تطلب لعملك شاهدا غير الله, that you're not seeking for your actions a witness other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is completely done with sincerity. And how important for us is that, my dear brothers, bearing in mind he said sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, خَافُوا هَذَا الشِّرْكِ فَإِنَّهُ أَخْفَى مِنْ دَبِيبِ النَّمَلِ, beware of the shirk that is khafi, that is hidden, that is hard to see. It's about showing off, it's about being pretentious and contriving, it's about not doing things sincerely for Allah's sake but wanting to please the people. Beware of this, because it's more hidden than an ant. It's more hidden than a dark ant. It's more hidden than a, like they would say, like a dark ant on a black rock in a black night. That's how hard it is to see. And so therefore he would teach us to say three times in the morning, three times in the evening, and we should learn and we should teach others to say, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika an ushrika bika wa ana a'lam wa astaghfiruka lima la a'lam. Oh Allah, I seek refuge with you from the shirk of what I know, and I seek your forgiveness for that which I do not know. Because perhaps you're not seeing the fact that you're being insincere. So that is the first thing to remember. Number two, Ibn Qudamah says, وَمِنْ ذَلِكٍ يَتَذَكَّرُ وَقْتْ إِحْرَامِهِ وَتَجَرُّدِهِ مِنْ ثِيَابِهِ إِذَا لَبِسَ الْمُحْرِمَ الْإِحْرَامِ لَبِسَ كَفَنَهُ. To remember, for those performing the Hajj, that when you're wearing your ihram and you're removing all of your garments and you're wearing only these two pieces of cloth, then it's as if you're wearing the shroud of death, my dear brother. It's as if you're wearing the shroud of death. Because perhaps the next time you will wear something that resembles this is when you have died already. But you're not wearing it, it is being placed on you. You're being attired with this, these two garments. Like the poet said, تزود من الدنيا فإنك لا تدري إذا جن ليل هل تعيش إلى الفجر فكم من أروس زينوها لزوجها وقد نسج أثانها وهي لا تدري. Take your provision from the dunya now because you do not know if you will survive till Fajr. When the night draws upon you and you think it's night time now, there's no guarantee you will live to see Fajr. For how many a wife, a bride has beautified herself for her husband, but she does not know that her shroud was being sewn for her. وَكَمْ مِنْ صِغَارٍ يُرْتَجَ طُولَ أَعْمَارِهِمْ وَقَدْ أُدْخِلَتْ أَجْسَامِهِمْ غُلْمَةَ الْقَبْرِ. And how many a child wishes to live for a very long time because he expects the future to come upon him, but does not know that his tender, weak, meek, innocent, child-like body will enter the darkness of a grave. How much did our Prophet ﷺ, how much did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instruct us about remembering death in the hadith on the authority of Abu Dharr al-Ghifari when he came, he said, Ya Rasulullah, Ayyul mu'mineena akyas, who is the most wise person? And he said, the wisest person is aktharuhum lil-mawti dhikran wa ashadduhum ista'dadan lahu. The wisest person is the one who remembers death the most and prepares for death the most. And this is why you will read in the stories of those who came before us, Umar bin Abdul Aziz, إِذَا ذُكِرَ الْمَوْتِ إِنْ تَفَضَ إِنْتِفَاضُ الطَّيْرِ. When he would remember death, or when he would be reminded of death, he would shake like the shaking of birds. He would shake like the shaking of birds. Abu Darda, may Allah be pleased with him, would say, when you're reminded of death, فَعُدَّ نَفْسَكَ كَأَحْدَهُمْ. Then include yourself as if you're one of those dead people already, because soon you will be one of those dead people. And so for the one who is wearing the ihram, he should have this in mind. I'm not wearing two garments for no reason, but this has a profound spiritual relevance. Like the poet said, مَرَّتُ عَلَى الْقُبُورِ فَمَا مَيَّزْتُ بَيْنَ الْعَبْدِ وَالْمَوْلَى. I passed by the grave. I couldn't tell the difference between the slave and his master. There's no way of knowing who's who. In the Hajj, there's no way of knowing who's who. Whether you're the servant or whether you're the master, you're wearing the same piece of cloth. And so you're in this very weak state, physically weak, but spiritually strong. And this is the essence, my dear brothers. Thirdly, وَمِنْ ذَلِكَ أَنْ يَتَذَكَّرُ. And from the Hajj is to remember, إِذَا رَأَى الْبَيْتَ الْحَرَامِ اسْتَحْضَرَ وَمَتُهُ فِي قَلْبِهِ وَشَكَرَ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى عَلَى تَبْلِيغِهِ رَتْبَةَ الْوَافِدِينَ إِلَيْهِ. When he sees the Kaaba, then he has this sense of eminence for the Kaaba in his heart. There are so many houses, my dear brothers. There are so many buildings and so many palaces. And there is a Hilton hotel here and this hotel over there. And there are these skyscrapers and there are all these wonderfully looking buildings. But none of these buildings in essence can allow us to reach to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah has allowed for one house to exist, my dear brothers. The first house that was erected for the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that when the believer sees it, his heart is full of eminence. And he thanks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa shakar Allah, thanks Allah for the fact that Allah has invited him to his house. The fact that Allah has invited him and called him to his house. And this is a very important thing for us to remember, my dear brothers. Having the quality of shukr, having the quality of thankfulness. وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ. Allah indeed says in the Quran that Allah has revealed to you, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, and to those before you. أَلَئِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ وَلَتَكُونَنَّ مِنْ الْخَاسِرِينَ. If you ever made shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will nullify your deeds. All of us, my dear brothers, if we ever made shirk with Allah, ever ascribed any partners with Allah, or set up a rival unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our deeds are finished, and then we will be one of the losers. بَلِلَا فَعْبُدْ وَكُمْ مِنَ الشَّاكِرِينَ. But Allah says, worship Allah, and be one of those who are thankful to Him. سبحانه وتعالى. In the Quran, ما يفعل الله بعذابكم إن شكرتم وأمنتم. What does Allah have to do by punishing you if you are thankful and grateful to Him and you believe, my dear brothers? So we should remember that. Like Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani and Ibn Rajab and so many ulama, they mentioned, إذا أنعم الله, if Allah gives the servant a ni'mah, if Allah gives the servant a blessing, then Allah indeed asked that servant to make shukr to Him, that Allah thanks him. فَإِذَا شَكَرُوهُ كَانَ قَادِرًا عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَزِيدَهُمْ. And if the servant thanks Allah, Allah is able to increase that servant. In the Quran, لَإِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ وَلَإِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. If you thank Allah, Allah increases you. وَلَإِنْ كَفَرْتُمْ إِنَّ أَذَابِ لَشَدِيدٍ. But if you are ungrateful to Allah, then Allah's punishment is indeed severe. And then he says, Ibn Rajab says, that وَإِذَا كَفَرُوا, and if they are ungrateful to him, كَانَ قَادِرًا عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَبْعَثَ عَلَيْهِمْ نِعْمَةُ عَذَابًا. Allah is able to send his punishment to them. Allah send his blessing to them as a punishment. Sometimes you see people, you think, well, they have so much of dunya, but they reject Allah. They don't pray, they don't even believe in Allah, but they have so much of dunya. And he says it's a ni'mah Allah gives them as a form of punishment to them, because it stands as a hujjah alayhim, as a proof against them on the day of judgment. The fact that Allah gave them so much, but still they made no effort with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمِنْ ذَلِكَ أَنْ يَتَذَكَّرْ. وَمِنْ ذَلِكَ أَنْ يَتَذَكَّرْ. And from that is to realize and remember. إِذَا سَعَى بَيْنَ الصَّفَا وَالْمَرْوَى يَنْبَغِي أَنْ يَمْثِلُوَ بِكَفَّتَيِ الْمِيزَانِ. When the one performing the Hajj is making sa'i between Safa and Marwa, the climbing, then the walking, then the running, then the climbing, then the walking, then the running, then the climbing, these 7 times, he should try and remember, it's almost as if these are the 2 scales of the Day of Judgment. The 2 scales of the Day of Judgment. The scales of one's good deeds and one's bad deeds. To remember that everything good and small is recorded by Allah. They will say, مَا لِهَذَا الْكِتَابِ لَا يُغَادِرُ صَغِيرَةٌ وَلَا كَبِيرَةٌ إِلَّا أَحْصَاهَا. The people, they will say, what is this book that I've been given? Everything in it is recorded. Even the smallest thing and the greatest thing is recorded in this book. But then there is a different consideration. To remember, of course, the sa'i between Safa and Marwa is your labor, in imitation of the labor of Hajar alayhi salam, who labored looking for water for her son, left in the wilderness, left by herself, and she's walking and running and climbing. Allah in the Quran says, وَأَلَّيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى وَأَنَّ سَعْيَهُ سَوْفَ يُرَى. Indeed, insan, man, human being will only have what he made effort for. And at the end of the day, he will see, it will be shown to him, his labor. His efforts will be shown to him. وَجُوهُ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاعِمَةٌ لِسَعْيِهَا رَاضِيَةٌ. Allah says on the Day of Judgment, the faces of those believers will be bright and shining. Why? لِسَعْيِهَا رَاضِيَةٌ. Because of the sa'i they made, they are pleased. And that is sa'i in dunya. Like you go to the Hajj and you make this sa'i, and it is quite hard in the heat after tawaf, right? It is not, you know, people feel exhausted. The sa'i, it feels hard when people perform it. For many people, particularly for women and for old people, it feels hard. But then that is life, right? That is the lesson of life. In life, for us to wake up in the morning for Fajr on time and to pray on time, perhaps in the beginning it will feel hard for people. But the more you do it, then Allah gives you ease by way of it. For you to spend of your money, right, like Allah describes in the Quran, those who feed people on a day of their own hunger. They feed people on a day of their own hunger. That is hard for people to do that. You're going hungry yourself to make sure other people are fed. That is a noble quality, one that Allah praises in the Quran. Or those who are miskeen, or those who are yateen, those who are poor, those who are orphans, you have to spend, feel the pinch from your own pocket to give to others in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or for you to walk to the house of Allah, or to read the Quran, or learn the Quran. Anything requires effort, my dear brothers. Just like the sa'i, it's a lesson in effort. We're making effort there, we must make effort. When we come back from the Hajj, we must make effort in all of the things good that we do in this life, pertaining to the dunya and the deen. There are many things of good in the dunya that we can also do, and all of the deen is of goodness and usefulness and benefit for all of us in dunya and akhirah. وَمِنْ ذَلِكَ And from the lessons of Hajj is to remember, the Arafah. وَأَمَّا الْوُقُوفُ بِعَرَفَةٍ فَاذْكُرْ بِمَا تَرَى فِيهِ مِنْ إِزْدِحَامِ الْخَلْقِ وَارْتِفَاءِ أَصْوَاتِهِمْ وَاخْتِلَافِ لُغَاتِهِمْ مَوْقِفَ الْقِيَامَةِ It's to remember when you're on Arafah and you see the multitude of people, all shapes, all sizes, all colors, all languages, and the raising of their voices in dua, and you see them and they all look so from all different kinds of countries. Assortment of humanity is there. What do you remember? You remember Qiyamah. You remember it, the Day of Judgment. Because that's how it will be. In Surah Al-Hajj in the Quran, the first verse, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّ زَلْزَلَةَ السَّاعَةِ شَيْءٌ عَظِيمٌ Oh, you believe, اتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمْ Have fear of your Lord. Indeed, the earthquake of the hour is a tremendously great thing. Right, an awfully great thing for people. It's a shay'un azim. It's a great thing. It's like anything else you've never ever seen before. As much as Hollywood and Bollywood trying to imitate by using their skills in movie production to create something realistic, and there's been so many movies for the last decade, so many depicting the end of time or something that resembles the end of time. It is nothing like that, my dear brothers. Where your imagination ends, that's where this narrative begins. Where your imagination ends, that's where this narrative begins. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّ زَلْزَلَةَ السَّاعَةِ شَيْءٌ عَظِيمٌ Oh, you believe, say your Lord, indeed the earthquake of that day is a great thing. يَوْمَ تَرَوْنَهَا تَذْهَلُ كُلُّ مَرْضَعَةٍ أَمَّا أَرْضَعَتْ وَتَضَعُ كُلُّ ذَاتِ حَمْلٍ حَمْلَهَا وَتَرَى النَّاسَ سُكَارَى وَمَا هُمْ بِسُكَارَى وَلَكِنَّ عَذَابَ اللَّهِ شَدِيدٌ That is the day the woman who is feeding her child will drop the child, will leave the child, has no concern anymore. And the one who is carrying her load, the one who is pregnant will drop her load. وَتَرَى النَّاسَ سُكَارَى And you will see people as if they're drunk. وَمَا هُمْ بِسُكَارَى But Allah says they're not drunk. They're not drunk except that they look like they're drunk people. But the punishment of Allah is severe. That is the day يوم الحساب, يوم القيامة, يوم الندامة, يوم التغابن. That is the day of regret. That is the day of mutual rivalry. That is the day of قيامة, of standing. لَن تَزُولَ قَدْمَ عَبْدٍ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَ حَتَّى يُسَلَ أَرْبَعِ خِصَالٍ The servants, all people will not move on that day, my dear brothers, until they've been asked about four matters, four issues. عَنْ عُمْرِهِ فِي مَا أَفْنَاهُ وَعَنْ شَبَابِهِ فِي مَا أَبْلَاهُ وَعَنْ مَالِهِ مِنْ أَيْنَ اكْتَسَبَهُ وَفِي مَا أَنْفَقَهُ وَعَنْ عِلْمِهِ مَاذَ عَمِلَ بِهِ About his life, how did he spend his life? About his youth, his young age. What a gift Allah has given us of being young, of youthfulness. The kind of energy, vitality, the kind of spirit that a person has when he's young is unlike that he might have when he's older. Right? That is a special age Allah has given him. Right? And how many, an older person would wish, of course, he was young once again to do the many things. May Allah bless our elderly in any case. But and about his money, where did he take his money from? And how did he spend his money? And about his knowledge, how did he act upon his knowledge? There are many things that we know. But of course, we are questioned about the things that we know. Right? Like when they would ask the Sahaba, they would say, they would say, the most fearful thing for me is that I will be asked, هَلْ عَلِمْتُمْ Did you learn anything in your life of deen? فَأَقُولُ نَعْمًا So I will say yes. And then it will be said to me, فَمَاذَا عَمِلْتُمْ فِي مَا عَلِمْتُمْ So what did you do with what you knew then? So what did you do with what you knew? That is the day, my dear brothers. يحشر الناس يوم القيامة على أرض بيضاء صفراء كرسة النقي ليس فيها علم لأحد. We will be resurrected. Humanity will be resurrected on a land that is whitish and yellowish in color like a loaf of bread. And there will be no landmarks for people on that day. There will be no place you will recognize. Say, I'm going to run to that place. People will say, أين المفر؟ كلا لا وزر إلى ربك يومئذ المستقر. They will say, where is the refuge? Where do we run to for safety? And Allah says, كلا لا وزر. There is no refuge إلى ربك يومئذ المستقر. Except that you're all heading to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Except that we're all heading to Allah, our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. يحشر الناس يوم القيامة صفاتاً وراتاً غرلاً. Man will be resurrected on that day naked, barefooted and uncircumcised. You're seeing the people on the Arafah in this kind of state. But the beautiful thing about Arafah is that people are begging their Lord for forgiveness, begging their Lord for clemency, begging their Lord for mercy. Right? Unlike other people, people might gather in stadiums to see people performing, whatever. It has no consequence in the hereafter, except that of course it could be against them in the hereafter, on the Day of Judgment. But here the people are gathering in their millions for a different purpose, and that is to beg their Lord for forgiveness and for mercy, and to ask the good of the dunya and the good of the hereafter, and to save them from the fire. وَمِنْ ذَلِكْ إِنْ يَتَذَكَّرْ إِذَا رَمَيْتَ الْجِمَارِ. And like that, to remember when you're throwing the pebbles on the jamarat. فَقْصِدْ بِذَلِكَ الْإِنْقِيَادِ لِلْأَمَرِ. Then remember by that the fact that you're obeying Allah, that you're fulfilling the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is how it is, my dear brothers, whether it's in the Hajj or outside of the Hajj, we have to live in obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That you're obeying Allah in the Hajj, and some people of course they don't. They have the money for a long time. They have the money saved for a very long time. And they've been to so many wonderful places on earth and seen so many wonderful things on earth. But the one place Allah ordered them to go to, or commanded us, those who are able and have the money and have the ability to perform the Hajj are obligated to do that. And there should be no delay in that. Who knows, of course, we will live to see the next year and the next days of Dhul-Hijjah. So those who haven't performed, they should have this niyyah, have this irad, have this intention, that if I haven't done it this year, although I know I'm capable and I have the money and it's all in order for me, but I keep delaying, then perhaps I should perform it the next year before time comes when I have no ability left to perform the Hajj because I'm now 6 foot under in the grave. So we should remember, my dear brothers, by way of the Hajj, there are many lessons for us to learn. It is, of course, and perhaps next time we can discuss the great importance of Ibrahim alayhi salam in our religion, the great relevance of Ibrahim alayhi salam and his sacrifice and his commitment to this, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and his sacrifice, that we remember these lessons and these examples. But those that we've discussed today is to try and understand the great significance, or perhaps symbolic significance, of the Hajj that many people overlook. We shouldn't overlook. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to be of those who are clear-minded in the Hajj. Hajj, of course, is not only a time for us as individuals, it is a time for the Ummah. Those who would, in the 12th century, particularly in the year 1099, the contingency of ulama who went to on the Hajj to make dua for Yusuf ibn Tashufin in Islamic Spain. Right, they went to make dua for him because he was a Muslim ruler ruling by the Kitab and the Sunnah, but he was having a hard time from the enemies of the Muslims, and they were collectively beseeching Allah to help the Muslims. We have many a difficulty in our day and age, many a tribulation in our day and age. We have struggles in Iraq, in Afghanistan, in Palestine. We have hardships in Pakistan. We have hardships all over the place. So we shouldn't simply go for our own individual purposes, but we should think about the Ummah. We should think about the suffering of the Ummah. We should think about those who are sacrificing their lives for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in defense of this Ummah. We should make dua for them and make dua Allah gives them sabat and istiqamah, and Allah keeps them firm, and Allah keeps us firm in for the rest of the year, that we are allowed to see the next Hajj. Of course, my dear brothers, we don't want to undermine the days coming upon us. We're coming from Ramadan,
and Allah gave us a few months as a middle period, but the days coming upon us, ما من أيام العمل الصالح فيهن أحب إلى الله من هذه الأيام. There are no days where good deeds are more beloved to Allah than those good deeds performed in these 10 days. The ulama, they only discuss whether the nights of Ramadan are more valuable than the days of this month. But as for the days, ما من أيام, there are no days where good deeds performed are more beloved than in these first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. May Allah allow us to see them. May Allah allow us to be of those who perform the good deeds in them. And may Allah accept from those performing the Hajj that they return free of all sin. That Allah accepts their Hajj. And may Allah gift them with the noble quality of sabr. What I forgot to mention, وَالْكَعْظِمِينَ الْغَيْظِ وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Those who subdue their anger and they forgive others, and Allah loves the doers of good. In Hajj, these 5 days, it can be very testing and hard. You have to be very patient. You have to watch what you say, watch your language, watch your behavior, and really, really be focused. And Allah praises those who subdue their anger and those who forgive other people. And Allah loves the doers of good. May Allah bless you and I and all of us with the quality of sabr. May Allah send His peace and blessings upon Muhammad ibn Abdullah, upon his pure family and companions. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen.